It's a bird. It's a plane. It's a trig function. Oh, just kidding. We're not going to be talking about those kind of powers of trig functions. We're going to be talking about trig functions raised to powers and how we can integrate them. So, for example, we've seen integrals of cosine squared before. Right? We had a trig identity that we could use. So we know that cosine squared of some variable, x, say, before we've used theta, molar than x, is that's equal to 1 half, in parentheses, 1 plus cosine of 2x, or whatever the variable was. We could do the same thing with sine squared, and we use the identity that sine squared of x is 1 half, parentheses, 1 minus cosine of 2x. And if you remember, the way I like to remember this is the either way, sine squared and cosine squared get turned into expressions that have a cosine of 2x in them. But the cosine is happy about it because it was a cosine squared, now it's a cosine of 2x. It's happy, so it gets the plus. And the sine squared is sad, so it gets the minus sign. So whichever way you want to remember that is fine. But that was a key thing that we've seen before, and we'll, of course, need that again, even more powerfully, pardon the pun. So, for example, if we had sine squared of 5x, we could use our trig identity that we had before, right? Sine squared of x was the old, was the previous screen, was 1 half 1 minus cosine of 2x. Now we have sine squared of 5x. So you have to, in some sense, read that trig identity as saying, what you do is you double the angle. This is sometimes called double angle formulas. So sine squared of 5x becomes 1 half 1 minus cosine of twice the angle we had before. So instead of a 5x that we had inside the sine squared to begin with, now we end up with a cosine of twice that, or 10x. So that's a place it's easy to make a mistake. Sometimes people will put cosine of 2x there instead of the blue 10x because they're thinking about the trig identity, not about what the trig identity really means. What it really says is take the argument, the thing inside the parentheses after the sine squared, and you double that when you use the trig identity. Okay, so we can either factor the 1 half out and leave it outside when we integrate, get a big parentheses, or, and I'll often do that. In this example, I'll multiply through. You can do it either way. I'm not so picky about how you simplify the final result. So if I multiplied through by a half, I'd have a half minus a half cosine of 10x, and then we can just integrate that. Now here's another example of a place where we're going to be doing what's technically u substitution, but very quickly and without going through any of the steps, because that's such a minor part of the problem. So when we integrate the half, well, that'll just be a half x. But when we integrate the 1 half cosine of 10x, you get 1 20th sine of 10x. So again, technically, I'm letting u equal to 10x, going through the whole u substitution thing. But maybe the best way to think about that is I'm doing the chain rule backwards. If I'd been taking the derivative of cosine of a bunch of stuff, then I would end up taking, well, sticking the derivative of the bunch of stuff out beside it, multiplying by it. Here I'm integrating, and so instead of multiplying like I do in the chain rule, when I integrate, I divide by the 10. Right? Again, we've seen this before, but I want to emphasize that we want to be able to do this step pretty quick because it's not the key thing that's going on in this problem. It's a really small part of it. So we want to be able to do that quickly and go on. If you're ever confused, and whenever I play with sines and cosines, I always do this because it's easy for me to make a mistake with a minus sign. I always just start here there at the bottom and take the derivative and go backwards. So the derivative of sine is cosine. So derivative of sine of some stuff would be cosine of some stuff times, of course, the derivative of the stuff. So I'd get an extra 10 that would be multiplied by that 1 20th, and sure enough, they cancel correctly, and I get back to a half. And because the derivative of sine was regular old cosine without a minus, so the minus that was in front still stays there. So in general, we can play this same game whenever we have even powers of sine or cosine. So for example, suppose we had cosine to the fourth. Well, our trig identity rides to the rescue again with its cape and hood and so forth. And so cosine squared, that identity is still what we need because we can take cosine to the fourth and write it as cosine squared all squared, right? If I had cosine to the sixth, I'd write it as cosine squared all cubed. Okay, so cosine to any even power, you could write it as cosine squared to some power. Now the red cosine squared part, well, I've got a trig identity for that, right? It's going to be ugly because that 1 half, 1 plus cosine of 2x that's in red, is going to get squared, which is going to make a big ugly mess, but it's a manageable big ugly mess, right? If I square all that stuff inside the parentheses, the 1 half will become a fourth, and I'll take that outside the integral just to get it out of the way. The 1 plus cosine of 2x, well, that's a binomial. It gets multiplied out. Remember, we have to FOIL it correctly, so we get 1 plus twice cosine of 2x plus cosine squared of 2x. So this looks like a big mess, but you see, each piece we know how to do now, right? The 1 is easy to integrate. The cosine of 2x is easy to integrate. The cosine squared, well, okay, we just did one like that, right? So we have to start over to deal with that and use our trig identity again, but it's not too bad. At least we know how to do it, right? Okay, so copy that integral up here at the first, and we use our trig identity on the red cosine squared. Again, this looks like a big mess, but that red cosine squared of 2x becomes 1 half, 1 plus cosine of 4x. Remember, the angle doubles, and this was a cosine squared, which got turned into a cosine, so it's happy. It gets the plus sign in front. Well, okay, so let's simplify the stuff inside the integral so we can integrate it. If I multiply that red 1 half through, it gives me a half plus a half cosine of 4x. That half I can add to the 1, which was sitting over here, to give me 3 halves, right? And I'll leave that extra quarter that was outside. It's been dangling around out there. I'll just leave it there. It's bringing inside is too much fraction to deal with, kind of fractions as it is. So 3 quarters from the constant terms, then 2 cosine of 2x, then finally 1 half cosine of 4x, because I have to distribute that 1 half through to the cosine. Okay, well, this is an integral we can do, right? Integrate 3 halves and you get 3 halves x. Integrate 2 cosine of 2x and that's sine of 2x. And again, I would double check myself because, again, I'm technically doing u substitution all in one step. That's why I divided by the 2 and this 2 doesn't appear. But if I were going to double check myself, the derivative of sine of 2x is cosine of 2x. With the chain rule, I get an extra 2. And sure enough, that works. Same thing happens with the sine of 4x, right? With the cosine of 4x, that becomes sine of 4x, but I have to divide by a 4 because of the 4 inside there with the x. And so I end up with 1/8 outside the sine. And remember, don't forget your plus c. Okay? So one of the moral of the story here is trying to take something that we didn't know how to deal with and reduce it down to something that we do. Next, we want to talk about odd powers of sine and cosine. So suppose that we had some sines and some cosines, and at least one of them has an odd power. So here's maybe the simplest case, where we have an odd power of sine, the power is just 1, right? And the cosine squared is sitting there, it's an even power. But as long as one of the set, either the cosine part or the sine part that we multiply together there, is odd, we could use this trick. We could just do u substitution. Because if I let u equal the cosine, well, the du would be a negative sine, and look, I got a sine sitting right there. So I use that extra odd sign as part of my du. So I'll end up picking up a minus sign because the du was minus sine of x dx. And the cosine squared becomes u squared, which when I integrate u squared, I'll get 1/3 u cubed. So I finally end up with negative 1/3 cosine cubed of x plus c. That's actually really easy. When there's an odd power floating around, this is a little easier than what we just did because I can use that extra odd piece, right, that extra odd term to give myself a shot at using u substitution. Here's a slightly more complicated example. So if I have a cosine squared and a sine cubed, well, sine cubed, I'm going to pull off one of those sines and use that to make a du. So I'll take one of those odd terms of sine, odd powers of sine, stick it next to the dx, that's going to become my du. That leaves me with a cosine squared, then a sine squared. Okay, well, what do I do with the sine squared? Well, there's another trig identity that maybe the most famous one that we haven't used yet in this lecture. That's the cosine squared plus sine squared is always 1. So you can always turn sine squares and cosine squares into each other, because in this example, our sine squared would turn into 1 minus cosine squared. The same, I could play the same trick if I wanted to use the cosine. So since I have an extra red odd sign floating around to use as a du, I turn everything else into cosines, because then that extra odd red sign will become my du for a cosine, where my cosine was the u. Okay? So in other words, I let u be cosine, I let the extra sine of x dx become part of the du. I pick up an extra minus sign again, but that's not too bad. I'll have a u squared and a 1 minus u squared. I can multiply those together and make it a u squared minus u to the fourth, and then I just integrate those. So I finally end up with a minus 1/3 cosine cubed and a plus 1/5 cosine to the fifth plus c. So the moral of the story here is, if you ever have strictly even powers of sine and cosine, then you use the old identity to deal with that. If one of those powers, though, is odd, then you peel off one of those odd powers, say, in this case, the sine, and turn everything into cosine. If it had been the other way around, if the power on the cosine had been odd, I would have pulled off that extra odd cosine and tried to turn everything into sines, and then I could have used u substitution. Now, we could play the same game using that sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1 identity. Sometimes called the Pythagorean identity, because it's really just the Pythagorean theorem with the hypotenuse squared divided through on both sides. We can use that identity to get another identity and play the same game with, say, secants and tangents, or even cosecants and cotangents. So, for example, here's this Pythagorean identity. If I divide through by, say, cosine squareds everywhere, well, sine squared over cosine squared is tangent. Cosine squared over cosine squared is just 1. And 1 over cosine squared, that's secant squared. So excuse me, the same way of turning tangent squareds into secant squareds, or vice versa, that we had before. And so that opens up doors to playing the same kind of games with secants and tangents. Or of course, if I had divided through not by cosine squared, but if I divided through by sine squared, I could get the same sort of identity, but with cotangents and cosecants. And I could use those. So again, what's kind of the moral of the story here? Well, I want to take a problem I don't know how to solve and use some identities to try to turn it back into a problem that I do know how to solve, either by using u substitution or by using an old trig identity that gets us reduced from sine squares and cosine squareds down to cosines of two x's. When I teach face-to-face, I'm able to tell a lot more stories and able to spend time in class developing more of a rapport and laughing and getting to know the students a little better. That's one of the things I don't like about teaching online. When I only have video lectures to reach students, we don't get to talk so much in a group. But I will pause for one quick story to maybe drive home my point about how to handle these integrals. So once there was a mathematician who was going for a job interview. So he had been a math major and he graduated and was excited and thought this was going to work out to be a great job. He expected to get the job, but as he's going toward the interview, he sees a building on fire. And he stops and he thinks, well, building on fire, I should go and help the people. So he rushes inside and he helps the people inside the building and gets them to safety and is a hero, and the police thank him for his work, and he goes on to the job interview, you know, dusty and smoky and terribly late. And when he gets there, the people said, well, why are you so late? Because they're worried, because mathematicians can be a little odd, and maybe, you know, there's something going on here. So he says, no, I'm sorry, but there was a burning building, and I had to stop and help the people from the burning building. And they said, oh, wow, that's amazing, you know, and so you're actually a hero. That was a great reason to stop and be late for the interview. The interview goes great. They're thinking, this is exactly the person we want to hire. But before they do, it does occur to them that mathematicians are a little odd, and maybe they should ask a question or two to make sure that he is, you know, more or less sane and okay. And so they said, well, we're really proud of you for stopping at the burning building, you know, and saving and rescuing people. He said, but let me ask you a question. What would you have done had you gone by and the building wasn't on fire? And of course, the mathematician stops and thinks for a second. He says, well, I guess then I would set it on fire because that would make it a problem I knew how to solve. So maybe you think that's funny or maybe not, but maybe it helps you remember the idea that what we're trying to do here is reduce problems down to something we already know how to solve.